Being civilized. I'm Al Winter, President and CEO of Genome BC, and it's my pleasure really to welcome you here, each one. So thank you for making the effort, particularly on a rainy night, to come here. This is the fourth annual Don Rick's Distinguished Keynote Address, and we'd like to make sure that it's a really memorable evening for you. We have a really exciting speaker tonight. We'll get back into that in a few moments, but I see a number of you here for the first time, so I'd like to tell you a little bit about Genome BC first. So Genome BC is a not-for-profit organization, really the catalyst for a successful life science sector, the goal of moving science really into applications which make sense for clinicians or for industry leaders alike. So if you think of genome and DNA, DNA is in every organism, every living organism. So our research spans a whole breadth of areas, including human health, that's the big one, forestry, fisheries, agriculture, environment, even bioenergy and mining. And these are sectors which are significant to BC and to our citizens. Since the beginning, which was around 2000, we're now managing an investment over that period of time of over $600 million. In 181 major platform and project areas. And that's really through the continued support of the BC government, the federal government, and over 300 partners who are co-funding with us on those individual projects. So we are very much appreciative of the investment in this area in British Columbia. Now, in addition to research, Genome BC is also interested in education and public outreach to foster understanding and appreciation, really, of the significance of genome science and the technology applications that come from it. So that's a little bit about us. That's a minor amount, and I think we've had some rolling slides here as well. So moving to this evening, for this evening, after the keynote address, our Chief Scientific Officer, Dr. Brad Popovich here, will moderate a 20-minute Q&A session. So if you have questions, this is the time to think of them. Following this, please join us for a reception in the lobby just outside these doors, and we hope the discussions will continue. Because part of what we want to do tonight is stimulate the thinking. And out of that comes discussion, and out of that discussion comes ideas, and sometimes those ideas are action, and we actually get progress in British Columbia, and that's what we want. Now tonight we recognize Dr. Don Ricks. So Don Ricks was one of the founders of Genome BC and our chair for four formative years. Now Don, if you didn't know him, was a physician who saw the need in his own practice for better diagnostics. And he founded a system of clinical labs, which today are known as life labs, across not just Ontario, not only BC, but Ontario and other provinces also. Now, interestingly enough, Don was a physician to Michael Smith, UBC's Nobel laureate, also a founder of Genome BC. And Michael Smith convinced him that genomics was an important science for the future. To quote A. Farris from our board as well, Don Ricks was a man of action, a man of vision, a man of compassion, and a great Canadian. He was a great entrepreneur, a committed angel investor, a generous and effective donor to many causes. Don was quick to support young entrepreneurs and educational initiatives. Where others saw problems, Don saw opportunities. His cheerful, constructive contribution to every organization he supported was an inspiration to everyone. His legacy and commitment will influence our community for generations. Now, Don passed away in 2009, and Genome BC decided that one way we could continue to recognize Don and his legacy is to establish this annual keynote address as a way to encourage and inspire our community. Last year's keynote address, for those of you that were here, was delivered by Dr. Eric Green. We learned about the applications of genomics to the pursuit of personalized medicine. Our keynote this evening brings us a very interesting perspective based on use of technology. So at this time, I'd like to ask one of our board members and past CEO of Vancouver Health Authority, amongst many other things, Ida Hoogler, to come and introduce this year's Don Ricks Distinguished Keynote Speaker.
Good afternoon, and thank you. It's my pleasure to be here this afternoon, and my honor to introduce the fourth Don Ricks Distinguished guest speaker. Dr. Eric Topol is one of those rare individuals who is a preeminent researcher in his field of cardiology and genomics, as well as a digital technology guru, and uniquely, a transformative leader with a vision based on the confluence of discoveries in both medicine and technology, and how these discoveries will shape the future of healthcare, or digital medicine, as he coins it. As a leader in the movement to modernize medical treatment through new and emerging technologies, he's an advocate of engaging the consumer more fully in their own healthcare management in new models of partnership with physicians and healthcare professionals. He's a strong believer that advances in social networking, digital infrastructure, sensors, biocomputing, mobile devices, coupled with enormous strides in clinical discoveries, will open the door to digitizing human beings with potentially enormous benefits in health outcomes and in efficiencies. Dr. Topol is a leading medical researcher in the area of cardiology and genomics, where his work has led to the discovery of genes that demonstrate that a person's risk of heart attack has increased, and he's pioneered new and more effective drugs and new advances in the treatment of heart disease. Currently, Dr. Topol is the director of the Scripps Translational Science Institute in La Jolla, California, where he is also chief academic officer of Scripps Health. In these roles, he's able to combine his knowledge of medicine and technology and write, debate, and advocate for a new model of how people will manage their health and exhort those of us in the healthcare system to open to and embrace the huge potential and indeed inevitability of a new paradigm. His influential and prolific research and writings, including the widely quoted and debated book, The Creative Destruction of Medicine, How the Digital Revolution Will Create Better Healthcare, have earned him numerous awards, including Director of the Decade, Doctor of the Decade by the Institute for Scientific Information, the most influential physician executive in the U.S. from Modern Healthcare's 2012 poll, and I say this with a bit of a raised eyebrow as a conservative Canadian watching the antics of our neighbors down south. He was proclaimed one of the 12 rock stars of science by GQ magazine. Those of you who don't spend much time in men's fashion and lifestyle magazine, that is not genomics quarterly. So, rock star, researcher, digital guru, visionary, I give you Dr. Eric Topol, someone who's shaping, not just talking about the future of healthcare.
Okay, that's not too bad. Maybe a fourth. So I want to encourage all of you to be trip is the 40th anniversary of the cell phone. Wade, how much back then?
Like a full pound?
Yes. Okay, so this week in Nature was the first carbon nanotube computer, which is can be down to the scale of 1,000th of a hair. And this is, of course, I keep taking Moore's law to the next level. It's a Stanford product, and it's still in its infancy, but this is the next phase of computing, a long way from where we were in 1986. To tell you that the digital world has invaded every other space except medicine, I give you an example here of the driverless car. It's not just Google driverless cars, they're all going to be driverless. Not for all rides, just like digital medicine is not for all circumstances of medical encounter. And these books, like Man Against Machine, the Third Industrial Revolution, which we're actually into right now, and this third book, The New Digital Age, what's really fascinating about these three books that are all out in the last year is that they barely mention a word about medicine, about healthcare. And why is that? Well, because the digital world has not come to medicine until now. That's really the premise. And so we are going to have this control alt delete for those of you back in the PC era that remember what that meant. We're going to have a control alt delete of how healthcare is rendered. And it starts out with little devices. These little devices will change our world. And I'm looking around the room, and I'm really surprised that you're not on your little device right now. Probably because you're, and I thought you would be at least tweeting or something. These devices change our everyday life. And they went in a very rapid time frame from the first iPod, BlackBerry, the smartphone, e-reader, and tablets, all within just an over 8-year span. And look how dramatic that has had impact on how we run our lives and so many aspects of it. So just think where that has gone, because now you look at people, this is what it looks like. And I constantly know this, and people kind of just walk me in the lobby of the hotel and here, everybody's looking at a device. What did they do when they weren't in a device? What did all these people do? So this changed our world. And now people can't even just look at one device that's surgically connected. Now they're looking at multiple screens, and we have a new species of man known as Homo distractus. And speaking of that, I put out a tweet in the summer that said, our average attention span went from 12 minutes in 98 to 5 minutes in 2008, and I asked in Twitterverse, what is it now? And I got an immediate response from a physician in Ireland. And he said, sorry, what was the question? That is the limit of our attention span now. Now, what's interesting is that there aren't that many, well, actually, there's a fair number of digital natives in the room. You know, these are people who are still in their 20s and they were born digital. I thought that was pretty young in the 20s. Then I saw another version of being born digital. And I thought that was pretty good until I ran into this. I said, wow, that's a real digital native. And then I really found a real digital native. Because managed your Facebook privacy. So we have now an amazing digital infrastructure that obviously connects people like never before. And that has accounted for the social networking craze. And by the way, I don't know if you realize this, but most social networking connects, for example, Facebook, are through mobile devices, not through laptops or workstations. And so this is what accounted for, without any question, the ability to mount an Arab Spring. And this book about each a portion of that by Whale Cohen, where on the cover tells the whole story. Sharing videos, ideas, emotions, pictures led to, particularly among the young people, this revolution. And the power of the people is greater than the people in power. Remember that with respect to healthcare. And so this is an article from Fortune about coming to healthcare, and here are some of those examples, like patients like me, so many others now. Millions of people with chronic conditions find virtual peers who have the same condition and wind up trusting these peers who they've never met more than their doctor. That's an outgrowth of the social media world. So more information generated in the past 2 years than in the history of man. A pretty profound and true statement. And that, of course, gets us to this concept of big data. And these two books, which I highly recommend if you haven't gotten into them, you can face the big data and then Nate Silver's The Signal and the Noise. That's the big challenge that we face now. There's not any shortage of data. It's a tsunami deluge of data. And will be about each individual, like never before. But we have to grapple with that. How are we going to deal with all this immense challenge of data? Now, one proposed solution is supercomputer. Again, part of this digital infrastructure that exists. So the IBM Watson, as you remember, was prevailed over the Union champions in Jeopardy. That is, interestingly, been deployed in healthcare, not only in certain medical centers, but also with a health insurer, one of the largest. And this article, which is the first week October Fortune article, which is out online. Today, the Ask Watson button provides a second opinion for an oncologist. That is, it accrues all the data that's known about a particular pathway, cancer, mutation, treatment, and then it says, but is it really more reliable? Might it replace some of them entirely? That's really the question at hand. How much of this tapping into this remarkable digital infrastructure will change the way medicine and health care will be rendered? So to sum up the digital jumps that have gotten us to where we are today, I started really with the cell phone as far as the first big breakthrough in 73. The personal computer followed soon thereafter, the internet, which is ever maturing, the different digital devices we talk about, sequencing, we will get into social networks, bigger impact than anyone can ever conceive, and then you have cloud supercomputing, all sets up this cumulative technology innovation to this great inflection of medicine, which I believe we're just starting right now. This is just the beginning phase of that. So right now, we practice medicine at a population level, which is really unfortunate because it means imprecision, it means waste, and it's really, I'll give you some examples. So today, at this time, in the U.S. at least, there's a tremendous debate going on about how much salt people should eat, which is completely idiotic. Why should there be one salt recommendation for all people when some people are remarkably salt sensitive and others are totally salt resistant? Why should there be one recommendation? That's population medicine. I'll give you another example, screening. We do mass screening. We were doing mass screening for prostate cancer with PSAs and mammography. We even have stamps in the US for this. And these are not very intelligent screening procedures. Let me just give you an example. All of them induce net harm, by the way. Mammography, net harm to women. PSA, tremendous amount of net harm, as you can see visualized here. Hundreds of people per 1,000 men screened were getting harmed by serial prostate biopsies. Even the person who invented PSA, Richard Aveling, he called it the great prostate mistake, and in an op-ed in the New York Times, he wrote, this popularity it led to an expensive public health disaster. Interestingly, this book, The Invasion of the Prostate Snatchers, captured a lot of attention. So, we now have the Consumer Medical Report. This is interesting because Consumer Reports didn't used to do so much on medicine. Now they're even rating hospitals and health systems. And they just recently reviewed the 11 most popular cancer screening tests. And they found that only three provided any marginal benefit. So, cancer screening remained stuck in a 1960s view. That was a statement that they made.
conclusion. And what I want to submit to you is that that's where we are stuck in all of medicine, not just cancer screening, because we practice population medicine, which is not acceptable given the tools that exist today. So we still live in this era of Ben Casey and Nurse Ratched, 1960. How do we get out of the 1960s? Well, one more example to hopefully cement the case that population medicine doesn't work. This is the most successful drug in history in the pharmaceutical industry, Atarvastatin, also known as Lipitor. These are the best data ever published for Lipitor. This is the prevention of death or heart attack in over 10,000 people who took Lipitor or placebo for a number of years. Now the difference was a 34% reduction in death or heart attack. That sounds pretty good. But the actual reduction, as you can see, is from 3% down to 2%, which means that for every 100 people, 99% derive no benefit except their laboratory test of their LDL cholesterol. And one person has a death or heart attack reduction. Is that the best we can do? This is population treatment based on not knowing about an individual. So this particular story of Stephen Jay Gould, a very noted scientist, who was told when he has a mesothelioma he would die within a matter of months and then live 20 years later. There is no average patient. In this book that just came out, average is over. That's the point. Average is over. We have to get beyond that. And that's really what we can do now, which we can never do before. So this is a segue to a new way of going forward, and that's at the individual level, which we never could do before. That's what's so exciting. So if you want to go to look at a map on Google, you're looking at a geographic information system, multiple layers. You look at the satellite, the traffic, you look at all this stuff. What if we could do that for a human being? Well, we can. And that human being looks like this. You have all these layers. You have the social graph, sensors, imaging, the sequence of DNA, the transcriptome, proteome, metabolome, microbiome, epigenome, and the environmental exposome. All these things now that can be quantified on each human being today. This is an extraordinary era, the most exciting time ever in the history of medicine. So let's talk about digitizing human beings, because that's what takes us to this individualized medicine capability. And the first person to do this actually was Michael Snyder, who heads up genetics at Stanford. And he had the so-called personal omics profiling. He didn't have all those layers, but he had a substantial number of them, and it included DNA, RNA, metabolome, and right now he's getting biosensors and microbiome. He's adding more to fill in all the different layers. And this is interesting. I call it panoramic because it actually captures almost virtually all the different omics. And by doing that, it involved a team of people and it can't easily be replicated or scaled. He was able to diagnose that soon after a viral infection, he developed type 2 diabetes. And then he changed his lifestyle and got his handling back to normal and not diabetic. And of course, very instructive because we never even thought that a virus could have that type of an effect. So that's the kind of thing that's interesting just from the very first person who had this GIS of a human being. Now let's go to some of these layers and see how much information you can get from each one. So here about social graphs and social media. I don't know if you've seen this report from Stephen Wolfram, who has come up with so much information for each Facebook registrant based on all sorts of archival but obtainable accessible information. It's actually extraordinary. Every time you go on the web, whether it's to do a search, whether it's to make a purchase, you're being digitized. What are your likes and what are your affinities? And so there's a cartoon that's been interesting about how not to be digitized. Lots of different things here, but I want to just, none of them work. You wear the crime scene booties, you unplug the computer from the power, but none of these things work. And this whole idea about privacy is kind of obviously very center stage, particularly in the U.S. And I thought this cartoon, which I got through Twitter, I should go right to that.
just dissatisfaction with physician. Another one that the person's coming down with the flu. Another one is pregnant but doesn't know it yet. Another one, how much they walk each day. Because, by the way, there's some phones now that you can have, you don't have to wear a wristband or an accelerometer is built right into the phone. But this whole issue about data security has become center stage. These are covers of some recent magazines like the New Yorker and the Economist. And this is the cartoon I wanted to mention I saw from Twitter. And it says, Ed said you're monitoring all our phone calls. And so Obama said, he's not your dad. Sensors. I had a patient I thought maybe has atrial fibrillation, so I prescribed this device, got this device in the mail. And then the next thing I know, I'm on a plane, and for some particular reason, I decided I'd hook up on the internet on the plane. I get an email that says, I'm in atrial fibrillation, now what do I do? Now, how did he know that? Because it was computer read, and he had the rhythm diagnosis. He didn't have to read a card. All he needed to do was be able to put his finger on the sensor. So now, sleep studies. I want to ask you, I don't know what it costs to do a sleep study in the hospital here in Vancouver. Anybody know how much it costs? If you have sleep studies here, I imagine. Okay, so in the US, it's reimbursed $3,000. A couple of places I visited, like Stanford, they charge $7,000. Now I want to ask you, if you were going to the hospital for the night, how could you possibly have a normal sleep pattern? And worse, how could you pay several $1,000 not to have a normal sleep pattern? Okay, so why don't you just get this reusable sleep monitoring device, which gets your oximetry, and it's just some examples of sensors to show you. And then just put your finger in the oximeter, maybe like that, and then you just say you want to get your reading. And let's see. Okay. So pretty quickly here, it will get my O2 saturation in my blood and my heart rate. And it has a noise like you're in the intensive care unit, which you can shut off. And when you put this on, you hear that? Yeah. And you tape it and you wear this over the night, you'll find out if you have sleep apnea and it doesn't cost anything. It's free. You save thousands of dollars. Because if your oxygen drops in the middle of the night and your heart rate goes up, you'll know you've had a sleep apnea episode. So right now I have 98% saturation and my heart rate is 55. And obviously, I'm not having any oxygen problem. But that's easy to do. And that would replace the need for sleep labs in a hospital. Anybody represent sleep labs here? Because you're about to be history.
Necklaces.
that monitor cardiac output and stroke volume, hemodynamics, non-invasively. There's a sensor for annealing that will get oxygen level, heart rate, sleep, temperature, all sorts of things. There's socks for diabetics, for preventing ulcers, all sorts of incredible sensors. I don't have time to look at all of them, but for example, just using the microphone of the smartphone, you can get 4-6 respiratory volume, potentially prevent an asthma attack or chronic pulmonary disease exacerbation. And you can digitize the voice and make a diagnosis of Parkinson's disease just in the voice, or quantify the mood, the state of potential treatment, or the problem of depression. There's contact lenses that will analyze tears, so for example, detecting glucose from tears, but also already available in Europe, constant monitoring for serious glaucoma, the eye pressure that goes to the smartphone. It's also sensors that get you into the mind. That's really invasive type of sensor. So for example, there's this Northern California 15 sensor EEG kind of a fashion head, I don't know what you call it. But it's been used now to, for example, control, turn the light on or off with your mind, or move someone else's hand or arm through the internet. This is scary stuff. So if you think that we're through with the sensor development, well, you ain't seen nothing yet, because it's starting to get into the brain, the mind control. You can digitize pills, so you know exactly the moment the person's pill has reached their stomach, because that's what activates it, and emits the signal. You can also, you know, the typical patient comes in, they don't know what pills they take, but they have the different colored pills and shapes. We just take a picture of it and say every pill exactly what it is, one picture with this particular app. So just last week, the FDA issued a guidance statement on all these apps and ads, and actually they're very permissive. They're only going to be reviewing the ones that have very serious, like for example, an ECG or glucose, but most of them they're not even going to review because they think that that's unnecessary. That's actually a very progressive thing. Okay, so this is a tweet. The smartphone will evolve to become a soulmate device. It knows your body better than you know it yourself. I believe that. I think that's really true. And we're still in the early stages of this. And you know, one of my real heroes, I never met this man, this great Canadian, but I admire his writing, and you're probably familiar with him. But Marshall McLuhan, who predicted all this stuff back in the 60s or even the 50s, but one of his notable quotes, by putting our physical bodies inside our extended nervous system by means of electric media, we set up a dynamic by which all previous technologies that are mere extensions of our bodies can be translated into information systems. This is in 1964. This guy's visionary, no problem. Amazing. So this, I think, is really where we are here in 2013. We've got a smartphone that is like a pluripotent stem cell. It makes a Swiss Army knife into a joke. In terms of what it can do. But look what it will do in the future. It will do medication adherence, remote monitoring, it will be a scanner, imaging device, all these biosensors. We'll talk a little bit about that on the chip, a gateway to the cloud to the computer. It will be the way that office visits are conducted for the most part, and certainly you can also monitor the environment. So this is amazing. So this cartoon takes us to the next phase of sensors. And so, I know you're laughing, say, well, that's not great. But, you know, we have sensors in our cars. We have sensors in our pets. I don't have sensors in our body. And that's the next day. So, we can't predict a heart attack today. I know we have some cardiologists here this evening. We cannot predict a heart attack. We have no way to do that. We have a lot of people we look at walking down the street saying, well, that person looks like the heart attack waiting to happen. But we can't predict who and when heart attacks are going to occur. And all this technology that we have, nothing has helped us do that. Nothing. So take, for example, these two gentlemen who died of massive heart attacks, who both had a normal stress test within weeks of their fatal event. And that's because a stress test only tells us about tight, narrow,
so you can get a heart attack ringtone. Now, when you get this ringtone, hopefully it won't induce a heart attack. But that's where this is headed, and this will eventually be a reality. Just like if you are concerned about a child that has a high genomic risk of autoimmune diabetes, it takes 5 years for the child to get pancreatic obstruction to develop diabetes. So you would have an embedded nanosensor to pick up autoantibodies to the islet cell, and then administer immunomodulation therapy to block any early attack. The same thing for cancer. The future of cancer monitoring will be with plasma-free tumor DNA, not with PET scans and CAT scans and all these other types of scans, because this is moment-to-moment monitoring. Blood under surveillance at all times through your smartphone. Now, I mentioned that you can do all sorts of assays. I just want to get into that a little bit more. The smartphone with a microfluidic attachment is a lab on a chip. So you can then measure liver function tests, thyroid function tests, the kidney function test, potassium, and on and on and on. And so also, you can change the smartphone into a high-powered microscope, and then you can image things like malaria, tuberculosis, and all sorts of other pathogens. And now let's get into scanning, because that's the intro of turning a smartphone into a scope. So first I want to show you this device here. This is an attachment to a smartphone that you just pop on, and that makes the best otoscope looking into the ear, be the same for an ophthalmoscope looking into the retina that you could ever imagine. So we're going to show that now with Colbert. He, just before I went to visit him, he had a perforated eardrum while diving on his vacation. So we go back. So here is going to Colbert looking in his ear.
So I'm clear that you had an eardrum.
Yeah, but I blew out the eardrum.
I thought you should take a look with the smartphone into your eardrum. Is that all right?
It's crushed and often.
But it's there, okay. All right. So, so basically, I put this right in here.
Yeah.
And I hope I don't hurt you at all.
No, I hope so too.
Part of a normal physical exam, but it isn't being appropriate.
80% could be part of the physical exam at no cost. We'll talk about being able to use digital technology to reduce costs. And what about all this other imaging that is probably mostly unnecessary? So in two medical schools in the United States, instead of giving out stethoscopes, they're giving out stethoscopes. So here at the South Carolina and more recently Mount Sinai, which is now in its second year this month, gave out all the first year students on their first day a real stethoscope, which is a step in the right direction. I don't know if you saw this this past weekend, Wall Street Journal, medical education needs major surgery, absolutely. And in fact, I had penned an article in this journal, Science of Translational Medicine, from dissecting cadavers to dissecting genome, and that is, why are we still dissecting cadavers? When you can do that all through 3D simulation, why aren't we just each medical student learning sequencing their own genome, and we're learning how to work with bioinformatics? And if they don't want to know about themselves, pick somebody else, but at least get into the future of medicine. So now let's get into sequencing. This is obviously the most exciting thing going forward. It will transcend sensing and its game. It has the biggest ultimate potential. And we have evidence that obviously, whether it's ACTG or 01, these are just digital characters. So let's put aside whether genomics is part of digital medicine. Certainly it is. And the cost, as you know, have plummeted. In fact, nothing in technology has ever seen, witnessed this plummeting of cost, like sequencing, which was in 04, $28.7 billion to do a human genome sequence. Now, today, it's about $2,500. And so this graph of the exponential reduction in cost, y-axis, there's never been anything in history that's done this, but we're not leveraging this in how we care for patients yet. So the debate is, okay, you can map, do a sequence of the DNA, but so what? Does it really help anybody? Does it save time? So are you familiar with this index patient, Nicholas Volker? Some of you are shaking your head, but this is the first individual whose life was saved for sequence. He was about to die in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and he had 100 operations. I don't know any human being who has withstood 100 surgical operations. But he was septic, and his pediatric team said, well, maybe we should sequence him because we have no idea what's wrong with him. That led to the causative mutation being found, and led to a definitive treatment. And so this is near the end of what would have been Nicholas's life at age 5, and now he's almost 8, and he's perfectly healthy. Perfectly healthy. And he's the first individual who's sequencing saved his life. Now, we have some examples. We have a program at Scripps that was modeled after the one in Milwaukee. And it seems like every major place ought to have one of these because a lot of people walking around with an unknown serious diagnosis, like Lily Rosewood, who has been confined to a wheelchair, now 16 years old. But she's cognitively incredibly sharp. But she has horrendous tremors. Her voice basically doesn't have one. And she can't sleep for more than minutes at a time. And so we sequenced, this is the first family in our program, now we have 15, but we sequenced Lily's genome and her parents, Steve and Yay. And that led to, oh, by the way, they went to all these medical centers throughout the US and a cumulative bill of $1.5 million at least. They didn't just go once, they went to these centers multiple times. No diagnosis. So this is a classic diagnostic odyssey. Not so uncommon. Estimated that a million Americans are going through this or have been through this already. So this sequence of the trio, Lily and her parents, led to a flood of data, as you can imagine. 240 billion data points for each individual. That is 40x coverage of each genome. And then this team in our group, Ali Torkamani, the bioinformatics group, had us filter and sort through all this to figure out what are the causative mutations. I won't take you through all the details, but just suffice it to say there was a lot of data to plow through. And what that led to was an elective diagnosis of two genes, two compound heterozygous mutations that accounted for all of Lily's symptoms. And that led to a drug therapy, which has led to marked improvement. Not that she can walk yet, we're working on that, but at least we've been able to have
couple weeks ago, I saw this woman in clinic, and this is a telling story, which I'm still really blown away by. Her name is Kim Gridsell, and she is now 55, but when she was 35, she had an episode of sudden cardiac death. And so she had a diagnosis assigned to a arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia, had a defibrillator put in, and she still continues to have that defibrillator go off now and then, like a year ago. So she certainly continues to have problems. But then, more recently, she was diagnosed with this from this progressive neurologic disorder, having another rare disease known as Charcot-Marie tooth. So she went to the Mayo Clinic for these workups. And she said to the cardiologist and the neurologist there, something doesn't fit here. I have these two rare diseases. Neither of them are my family. What's going on here? And they said, well, you're just really bad health. It's really bad health. So she spent the next 2 years researching herself. She had a pre-med at UC San Diego, but she had no other training. And she just went to the web to study what could be the link that would bring these two rare diseases together. And she ultimately decided, well, I know the gene, it's lamina, and this can cause everything. So she went back to Mayo Clinic and she asked them to do targeted sequencing on her lamina gene. And indeed, she had a pathogenic mutation there that does appear to explain everything. And in fact, so she really was misdiagnosed at a molecular level, and she made the diagnosis herself. Imagine that. Okay. So we can even do single cell sequencing, which we did for those endothelial cells that are coming off the artery of heart attack individual. That's exciting. And that's really changing a lot of things, like understanding heterogeneity in cancer, tumor tissue, for example. So that's exciting for cell-to-cell variability, which there's a lot more of than we expected. And so interestingly, I don't know if you saw this, this defies genomics 101, that the DNA in all our cells is the same, that we're actually all mosaic. We all have some cells that have had some somatic mutations without even having to have cancer. And so that's really interesting. And that also brings us to this now, the ability to genome edit. And this cartoon that Ted was really edited as a child. Now that, of course, is quite futuristic, but we have been working on that. We have a project where we're actually taking the locus of genomes of people with heart disease, coronary disease, and taking out the locus, editing it out and putting in a healthy locus to see what happens in the dish in terms of these cells. This is a picture of that. This is the 9P21, a famous locus of the genome, which is not coding, but it seems to be highly linked with coronary artery disease risk. So we're taking that, we've been able to take that out in a homozygous fashion, and now we're in the midst of swapping it with what we call the well-early, which are people who never had any disease. This is just a demonstration of that ability to knock out coronary disease in the dish, not yet in patients. So one other thing that sequencing has done for us is discover rare variants. Rare variants that are really powerful, like just a couple weeks ago, the macular degeneration, the most common cause of blindness. And this, now we have variants from sequencing that have up to a 23-fold risk, 23,000 times risk of developing macular degeneration. So that's actually remarkable. And a lot more of those to come now that we're in the sequencing era. Cancer genomic. Obviously, this is genomic disease. And so obviously, there's so much that we can learn from. And so this recent Wall Street Journal article about breakthroughs. Yes, breakthroughs spark the cancer treatment. What are these breakthroughs that are changing the face of cancer today? And this past week, last Thursday, there were four articles in Nature Genetics. So here you see a GIS of tumor tissue with all the different omics that you can do of tumor tissue today. So you can, of course, do a paired sequencing of the tumor and of the native germline DNA and find out what are the driver mutations. And you can look at all the different levels of proteomics and RNAs, and clinical data, and you can come up with a very likely successful therapy. And you can also diagnose the pathway that are causative for this person's cancer. And what's great now is we now understand the different 200 or so genes that are the common causes of cancer. understand the 12 different pathways that are fundamental to developing cancer. We didn't know any of this stuff a couple of years ago. And furthermore, it's no longer breast or prostate or lung. It's about a mutation, about a pathway. That's the principal way we're going to be talking and treating cancer in the future. So for example, colon cancer now divided into 6 subtypes, which completely change which therapy and what would be the prognosis. Uterine cancer, 4 different subtypes, based on the mutations and the pathways that are involved. This is a whole different approach. So we also, as I mentioned, can follow people with cancer through their blood, plasma, and DNA, and be able to know what the treatment's effective. And that's exciting because that eliminates the need for these very expensive and high radiation risk of PET scan. This, to me, is perhaps the most exciting part of all. Now that we are moving into this era of people having so much data, willingness for people to share that data for their fellow man. And this is an article that just went out earlier this month. Patients share DNA for cure. What is it? Here, the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society has given $8 million to Oregon Health & Science University to work with Intel and Illumina for every patient that they see that develops a lymphoma or leukemia to share that data and make a common database for access for anyone. Any new individual who comes to match up the sequence, the treatment, the outcome, that's really exciting, and that's what we need to do across the board. I call this concept MOOC, which is a massive open online medicine. And it's a takeoff from MOOCs, which is obviously the creative destruction of current education. And this is a really exciting time for that. What about pharmacogenomics? Once you know a variant in a person who's responsible for a drug side effect or a response to the drug efficacy, these are reviewed that we put together all these commonly used drugs, and the amount of effect is extraordinary. We're not using that information in daily practice. So let me just give you one example, somewhat gory, but this is named telling. This is a Stephen Johnson syndrome from the drug Tegretol, carbamazepine, which occurs in 1 out of 800 people or so. And it is preventable by doing a genotype. But nowhere in North America are genotypes being done when this drug is being given for various things like neuropathy, trigeminal neuralgia, seizures, even bipolar disorder. This is fatal in 1 of 4 people. It hit home recently when a colleague of mine's wife developed trigeminal neuralgia, first dose, wound up in the intensive care unit for a week and almost died. Why don't we do a genotype? Just we have the data. It's been published back in 2001. It's 3 years later, or 2 years later, and we still haven't used this in practice. This is the exemplar of having knowledge and not translating into medical practice. But here's the allele with a 26-fold risk of developing Stevens-Johnson syndrome after exposure to this drug. Another example, the highest sales of drugs today is one class of medicine called TNFY. Humira, Enbrel, Remicade, advertised heavily on television in the U.S. Unfortunately, that's not legal in Canada unless you're watching American television. And it's amazing because these are now over 30 billion. This data is from a year ago. Now, well over 30 billion. What's the response rate of these drugs? What percent of people actually clinically respond for their rheumatoid arthritis? Any rheumatologists here? Any guesses?
Well, percent.
No, it's not that bad. You're getting cynical on me. 30%. So that's a waste of 70% times 30 plus billion or $20 billion a year just on these three medicines. Why don't we require, before these medicines go mass scale, why don't we require that we know the genomes that determine response? And we have very limited information. Only 100 some drugs, at least in the US, have a genomic label providing guidance for a physician, and most of them aren't even used. So we even now have a smartphone that can do a genotype in 20 minutes, or can do a quantitative polymerase chain reaction for a pathogen in 20 or 30 minutes. And so we have these kind of devices that are exciting, and maybe they'll be someday in pharmacies, because physicians are not using them, maybe the pharmacists can use them. We have prenatal medicine that is self-going for a revolution. This really hit home recently. Our daughter is expecting, and this is amazing. revolution in prenatal medicine. And so you can diagnose all sorts of chromosomal abnormalities like trisomy 21. And this is the report that you see. Negative for all these, and you're going to have a boy in this case. And this is all done 8 weeks of pregnancy. You can never find out this information except for an amniocentesis before. That's history. You don't need to do that anymore. And pretty extraordinary. And its accuracy is amazing, 99.9%. So this is pretty exciting. That's not even sequencing. That's just looking at chromosomal aberrations. What about the heel stitch? The poor baby comes into the world, and one of the first things that happens is they have their heel stuck for blood. Why are we doing that? Such a dumb test. We can sequence their entire genome. And this is from Nature a couple weeks ago, the day when all children will be sequenced at birth and not before, draws ever near. That's true. Okay, that's sequenced. I'm not going to get into all the different omics, but I did want to just touch on the microbiome, because that's like the hottest thing right now. And you see it everywhere. Here's the New York Times. This is our friend of germs. You see it on Scientific American, microbes, made it made in the Congress, the Smithsonian. Why is this such a big topic? Because there's so much information lurking in our microbiome, our gut microbiome, for example. Here's 100 trillion bacteria, of which the genomic information is odd order more than our own genome. And that is leading to these sorts of observations, that if you take an obese person's stool sample and use that as a fecal transplant to a mouse, you can make a lean mouse fat. That's pretty amazing. And all sorts of implications in diabetes, cancer, immunologic diseases, and the list goes on and on. All sorts of information we didn't know was in our microbiome. And then there's the epigenome, which is cell-specific, tissue-specific, but has amazing amount of information. Basically, where we used to be and now where we are today in terms of regulating the genome. It has an amazing amount of governance and checks and balances, the likes of which we never fully anticipated. This article just came out this week, mapping the human genome. It's possible now. And getting an extraordinary amount of information from the epigenome in terms of methylation and chromatin histone modification. Lastly, we can monitor the environmental scan, the exposome. And there are apps to your smartphone that measure radiation, electromagnetic interference, water, nitrates, all sorts of stuff. So let's put this all together. And the exemplar case, pulling this all together, is Angelina Jolie. We know this whole story, I think. But just to review, the op-ed that she wrote in May, which is called My Medical Choice. That's the future. People driving their choice. So she had a mother who had ovarian cancer. And she decided that maybe she had some kind of genetic predisposition. Her physician told her she shouldn't have BRCA1/2 sequencing. But she said, no, I want to have it. And so she did and found out, of course, that she had a very high-risk mutation. And this led to having she decided, again, to have a double mastectomy. So what is known as the Angelina effect is bringing into the public eye genomics, the power of genomics, and the power of choice. She made the call on all of this. And this is exciting because this effect is leading to better knowledge of genomics in the public, that it has an impact. And it also is such a great example of changing an outcome, potentially, which what she did, which is preventing breast cancer. And that's pretty exciting. So your magazine, McLean's magazine, which I didn't know before, but this cover art, is that a pretty good magazine?
Yeah.
Anyway, so this was a cover not that long ago, and they called me up, and I gave a quote, and it was the most radical change in the history of medicine we're looking at here. Yeah, the smartphone will see you now. That's true. And the webcam will see you now. And you can get all sorts of vital information through a webcam. You get the DNA's temperature, all sorts of things. Here's the cover of the Atlantic magazine, The Robot Will See Me Now. That doesn't sound too good. But it also says, is the doctor obsolete? Who would ever thought we could ask that question until now? That's a shame. And so you can, instead of going to the dermatologist, do you have any dermatologists here today? Well, you would become more efficient. Instead of just doing all these biopsies, you only do the ones that fail when they had a scan and got a text back.
got to say, you need to get a virus. The rest of them tell you not to worry about it. And they've invalidated at least some of them. Why would you go to an optometrist to get your eyes refracted? Any optometrists here? Watch out for them. Because you can just do this through a disposable or $2 attachment and just get your eyes refracted with a text to get your glasses made. And that's pretty exciting, particularly in a developing world where people couldn't see and all of a sudden now they're getting glasses and then you can read and do all kinds of things. What about the child who has a possible ear infection? Why would you go to the emergency room? Pediatricians, number one reason to see a pediatrician. Why would you do that when you have an idiot-proof smartphone device that you can just put in the child's ear, get a magnified 10x view, and then get a text saying your child does or does not have an ear infection? That's pretty exciting. So, squeezing out the doctor. That's where we're at. And, you know, your MD is an hour. Yeah. This was in last week. I don't know if you saw this. It's in the Wall Street Journal. This is telling a story. Robots versus anesthesiologists. Look at the subtitle. New sedation machine promises cheaper colonoscopy. Doctors push back. I wonder why doctors are pushing back. So now you can do a sedation through a computer. You don't need an anesthesiologist. And what's interesting is look at the anesthesiologist charge. They charge for a colonoscopy in the red more than the gastroenterologist. So some of the doctors are not too unhappy about this. But this is another invasion of the digital world into the practice of anesthesiology. So now there's this push to come up with a tricorder for those Star Trekkies here that will do all this kind of stuff through a little device. And the whole idea is that medicine becomes an information science test to be taken on by patients. There's even a course at MIT which is training people how to make a tricorder. That's amazing. Okay. So just to wrap things up. Today we have information asymmetry. You have the patient has to beg to get their information from the doctor. Call, what would my lab test show? What did my scan show? They're lucky if they ever find out. That's at least in the US. So the information is very different. It flows through the doctor. In the future, it flows to the patient through smartphones, through tablets. And the information is much more rich, and there's information parity. And that's really exciting. So that gets us away from the need for hospital. Why do we need a hospital? George Orwell in 1946 said it was the antechamber to the tomb. It still is today for one out of four people who are harmed in a hospital. And it's very expensive. So here is a design by a company for the hospital room of the future. Wow, it's pretty fancy. Got all the vital signs are on the wall and all this big plasma screen. So wow, that's pretty impressive. Here's some bulbs of the hospital room of the future. I have a design for the hospital room in the future. This is it, right here. There is no need for a hospital room except intensive care rooms or operating rooms or procedure rooms. We do not need hospital rooms. Well, we can just do all that stuff outside of the hospital. And if you weren't convinced by me, here's George Halverson, the CEO of Kaiser. And you probably know that Kaiser has a lot of hospital rooms and a lot of clinics. Here's what he has to say about it. Start delivering health care farther and farther from the hospital setting and even out of the doctor's office. Get people to take more responsibility for their own health. Why do we have clinics? Why do we have physical visits? We can do that on exception, but for the most part, we're better to do that remotely, virtually, much more efficient. And this study showed that it saved $80 per individual to do a virtual visit, and that was compared to the physical visit. The patients loved the virtual visit, and Cisco did a poll of thousands of Americans, and 70% preferred a virtual visit as compared to a physical visit. 70%. So, let the patient revolution begin. That's what I would like to see. That's what this is really setting up. It's really an exciting potential. And it's certainly, I think, the future of medicine. So I'll leave you with the thought that when we can digitize human beings, it's incredibly disruptive. It is a creative destruction because it turns out we can replace hospitals and clinics. We can change precisely given medication. We can change the doctor-patient relationship into a partnership. And we can manage much better or prevent many of the conditions in medicine. And this is exciting, but also there's this other loop. When individuals are sharing their data, and you have
particular strength here because you have such accessible data and populations here in British Columbia. But that sets up this democratization, this whole massive online medicine potential, which is even exciting because it's individual data at a population level. And that's really going to be extraordinary. So I want to thank you for attention and acknowledge a lot of my colleagues at Scripps. Really appreciate the opportunity to be here with you.